Thank you very much, Madam Speaker. And as always, it's a pleasure to stand in the House on behalf of my constituents to call for common sense in this case from this government. We have been calling, as common sense conservatives, calling on the government, the SDTC, which is the Sustainable Development Technology Canada, and the Auditor General to hand over all documents related to the Prime Minister's Green Slush Fund to the RCMP. Now, that matter was decided in the House of Commons by a vote of the House of Commons. And one of the privileges of parliamentarians of this House is, in fact, to call for the production of papers, to demand papers from the government. And as we know, right now we are in a privileged debate because the Speaker himself has determined that there is a prima facie case. On the face of it, it appears as though the government has violated the privileges of members of Parliament. That's why we are now days into a discussion about the Prime Minister's refusal to comply with a direct order of the House. Because refusing to comply with an order of the House by this government violates each and every one of our privileges. And as is evidenced by the fact that no other business is allowed to take place, the Speaker has said no other business may take place until this matter is disposed of. Because it is so serious when members' collective rights or members' individual rights are violated, that the House must stop all other business. All other business goes to the bottom of the pile until we have addressed this issue. So this is as serious as it gets for Parliament. There is no bills being debated. There are no private members' bills being debated because this is the most important issue that we have to deal with. And it's all because the government has refused to comply with a lawful order of this House of Commons. But Madam Speaker, after question period, I will be happy to continue to talk about this and about the pattern of corruption and ignoring the will of Parliament that this Liberal government, enabled by their friends in the NDP, has undertaken. But this is a serious matter. Our collective rights as a House of Commons have been threatened. The Speaker has said there is a prima facie case for this to be discussed, for this to be considered, and it must take precedence over every other matter that is before the House. So I know I don't have a lot of time before SO31 start, but I look forward to, after question period, resuming this discussion about the government's breach of the privileges of members of this place, Madam Speaker. I'll be able to get started by then, Mr. Speaker. Thank you. As was just indicated by the table, we are debating a motion today on privilege, and I wanted to read into the record some information on parliamentary privilege from the rcommons.ca website, which indicates that parliamentary privilege refers to the rights and immunities that are deemed necessary for the House of Commons as an institution and its members as representatives of the electorate to fulfill their functions. It also refers to the powers possessed by the House to protect itself, its members, and its procedures from undue interference so that they can carry out effectively their principal functions, which are to legislate, deliberate, and hold the government to account. Parliamentary privileges were first claimed centuries ago when the English House of Commons was struggling to establish a distinct role for itself within Parliament. These privileges were necessary to protect the House of Commons and its members from the power and interference of the King and the House of Lords. The privileges enjoyed by the House and its members are part of the Constitution and are vital to the proper functioning of Parliament. This is as true today as it was centuries ago when the English House of Commons first fought to secure these privileges and rights. Mr. Speaker, that puts into perspective here that this is a very serious matter, that any time we are talking about the privileges of the House of Commons, we are talking about a serious matter. And that, again, as I said before question period, is why no other business can take place, because protecting the privileges of this House is deemed to be the most important thing that we can do. And that is why the Speaker took the opportunity to deliver a ruling saying that he believed that on the face of it, it was a breach of the privileges of the members of this House and indeed of this House itself, that the government had refused to turn over documents after a lawful order from the House of Commons. And that is what we are discussing today. And all of the bluster and blarney that we heard from the government during question period about how this is somehow about the Charter of Rights and Freedoms is absolute nonsense. This is about the privileges of the House of Commons, the privileges that we have to uphold the rule of law, the privileges that we have to demand documents, to demand papers of the government. It might seem like a quaint thing to refer back to the King and the House of Lords, but without protecting the privileges of this House, we have no authority. And we have a government that can run roughshod over the will of the elected House of Commons, which is what they are trying to do right now. This is a lawful order from not just the Conservative Party and the official opposition, from the majority of the House of Commons. The majority of this House has demanded papers and has done so legally and after consulting with the legal counsel of the House. These documents have been requested. They have been demanded. The government has no authority to redact the documents, to hand over some of them, or in the case of the Privy Council Office, to tell the departments to ignore the request of the House of Commons. That is a breach of our privileges, and that is why we're discussing this instead of things like millions of Canadians lining up at the food bank for the first time. And as we heard in question period today, while Canadians are lining up at the food bank, Liberals are lining their pockets. It's a good time to be a Liberal insider. And that's what we found under the Sustainable Development Technology Canada Fund, where 186 times the board was found to have been in a conflict. They made decisions on money based on a conflict of interest. There was a conflict involved. 186 times. That's why the Auditor General has gotten involved. Nearly $400 million of funds from this government have gone to Liberal insiders or have been questioned by the government. $400 million. And that's why the House of Commons, not the Conservative Party, the House of Commons has demanded that the Auditor General and the government hand over the documents to the RCMP. The RCMP will do with them what they will. But that is not a decision for the government to make. An order has been given from this House to produce the documents, to give them to the RCMP, and they can use those documents to form their own opinions. But we cannot have a situation where a lawful order of this House is ignored, is amended, or is changed on the whim of the Prime Minister and his office and his bureaucracy in the PCO. That is not how the House of Commons works. And the government, I believe, has violated the privileges not only of individual members, but of the House itself. The document I referred to goes on to talk about the structure of privileges. It says the privileges of members of the House of Commons provide the absolute immunity they require to perform their parliamentary work, while the collective or corporate rights of the House are the necessary means by which the House effectively discharges its functions. These rights are enjoyed by both the individual members of Parliament, because the House cannot perform its functions without its members, and by the House as a whole, for the protection of its members, as well as its own authority and dignity. And it goes on to list the individual rights and immunities, the freedom of speech in the House of Commons and committee, freedom from arrest in civil actions, exemption from jury duty, exemption from being subpoenaed to attend court as a witness, freedom from obstruction, interference, and intimidation. And then it talks about the collective rights of the House of Commons, to discipline those found in breach of privilege or in contempt, and to remove members for misconduct, to regulate its own internal affairs, including its debates, agenda, and facilities, to maintain the attendance and service of its members, to institute inquiries and demand papers. It is very clear that when our rights are violated, when we are not able to demand papers or our lawful demand for papers is ignored, that the rights of the House have been violated. And that's why we're here today, because we cannot stand idly by while the government arbitrarily decides that they are above the elected House of Commons, that they, what they believe is right supersedes what the House of Commons has voted on and has determined is the right thing to do. Because if we allow this to happen, if the government can just ignore all of the rules, all of the votes of the House of Commons, where would we be, Mr. Speaker? What if Canadian citizens took the same approach and were able to simply ignore the work that is done here in the House of Commons? That would not be a system that any of us would want to live under. So it is hard to overstate the seriousness of a matter when the rights and privileges of Parliament are under threat as they are today. But it's not the first time that this government has done something of this nature when they've been faced with a ruling or a decision of the House that they didn't like. You'll recall in June of 2021, where the Liberals took the Speaker of the House of Commons to court to block the release of unredacted records about fired scientists under the Winnipeg lab scandal. They took a Liberal Speaker to court. The Government of Canada, the Liberal government, took a Speaker to court. It has never been done before in the history of Canada, because they were so afraid of what would be revealed there, and so afraid to allow the will of the House of Commons to be followed, that they were going to go to court to undermine the privileges of the House. And if you read through this, any of the news articles on that matter, it said here, the Speaker's office will defend the rights of this House. This is something I take very seriously. The legal system does not have any jurisdiction over the operations of the House. We are our own jurisdiction. This is something we will fight tooth and nail to protect, and we will continue to do that. That was from the former Speaker of the House. He said, and Mr. Dufresne, the former law clerk of the House, said the House has exclusive authority when it comes to matters that fall under parliamentary privilege. So this government has gone to extreme lengths before, and they're doing it again to protect themselves, to protect Liberal insiders from having their secrets revealed, from having documents that have been lawfully ordered by this House actually tabled as required. But we know that the Liberals don't have much time for this House. It's a nuisance. It's not something they value. It's not something that they honour. We saw this with Bill Morneau during the COVID, when this House was actually shut down. We saw Bill Morneau try to circumvent the rights of members of Parliament to examine and vote on budget matters for 2 years. He tried to circumvent the rights of this House. Luckily, it was the Leader of the Opposition that, at the time, the finance critic, who found that little nugget buried away and called it out and put a stop to it. But that is where their mind is at. Wherever they can, these Liberals will undermine Parliament for their own benefit. We've seen a number of times. We have actually, Mr. Speaker, if this matter is dealt with, if this breach of privilege is dealt with by this House anytime soon, which I think many of us have things that we want to say about that. The government, of course, could end this today by complying with the lawful order of the House of Commons and releasing the documents that the House of Commons has demanded that they release to the RCMP. This could all be over this afternoon. But we know that that is not the inclination of the government, because they believe they know best. They don't have to abide by the rules. And they're putting that on display. But there's another, in the meantime, there is yet another question of privilege that is waiting in the wings. The next item of business after this one is done will be yet another question of privilege because this government has failed to comply with the wishes of the elected members of the House of Commons. We've seen time and time again where this government has broken their promises. In 2015, in the election that brought them to power, the Prime Minister said, "It's time to shine more light on government and ensure it remains focused on the people it is meant to serve. Government and its information should be open by default. Data paid for by Canadians belongs to Canadians. We will restore trust in our democracy, and that begins with trusting Canadians." He said he would not resort to legislative tricks to avoid scrutiny, and he would not use prorogation to avoid difficult political circumstances. Well, of course, he did that in August 2020 to shut down investigations on the We Charity scandal, and the Information Commissioner has warned that the access to information has deteriorated to the point where it no longer serves its intended purposes and no longer meets the expectations or the needs of Canadians. So this government holds this House, and it holds its right to call for the production of papers, a defined privilege that the House has. The government holds that in contempt. And they have said, we do not recognize the authority of the House. We serve a higher authority, and that's the Prime Minister of Canada. And the Prime Minister of Canada is supposed to be a servant of this House, not its master. And it should not be directing the House of Commons to violate the motion that was duly passed by the majority of the members of the House of Commons. That is exactly what this Prime Minister has done. He has ordered his PMO and his department, the PCO, to ignore the lawful order of the House of Commons because he believes he knows best. It is the House that knows best. It is the House that has to exercise its rights. Because if we don't protect those rights, they will continue to be eroded under this Liberal government that doesn't care about them at all. So we would love to be discussing things like the failed Liberal bail policies that allow a violent repeat offender to shoot a police officer in Toronto yesterday. We would love to be talking about ways we can make that better. We'd love to have a debate about, you know, whether it's a bad thing to call the offender names when he is a known violent repeat offender who just shot a police officer, and we see the Liberal government and the people propping them up getting up and decrying the language used to describe those individuals. We'd be happy to have that debate, but today we have to have the debate to protect the rights and privileges of the House of Commons. The government could make this go away today by complying with that order, by complying with the lawful order of the House of Commons. If they do not, Conservatives will continue to stand up for the rights and privileges of the House of Commons, because we are sent here by Canadians to do the people's business, and this place must continue to be held in the highest regard. It must be the place that is the highest authority when it comes to the people's business, and the rights and privileges of this place must be respected by the government if we are to continue to hold this government to account. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Questions and comments. Question et commentaire. The Honourable Member for Nepean.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I have a very simple question for my Honourable Member. RCMP has written to Law Clerk of the House of Commons in July, stating that any records they receive through this process, they will not be able to use it because it affects the charter rights of the suspect. My understanding is...
Okay, right, 18 minutes.
Sorry, I think there's a problem with interpretation. There's no interpretation currently, Mr. Speaker.
Speak English and hope that the translation service gets it. Okay, perfect. The Honourable Member for Nepean can start again.
Oh, thank you. Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I have a very simple question to ask the Honourable Member. RCMP has written to the Law Clerk of the House of Commons in July, stating that any records they obtain through this process, they can't use it because it affects the charter right of the suspect. The end goal is any but he has done a criminally wrong thing, should be prosecuted. But the process that we are debating here, the process that the member is asking here, is not going to achieve that. So my question to the member is, does he think that RCMP has no other legal process to obtain this document or documents legally so that they can use it to the fullest extent in prosecuting anybody who has done anything wrong?
The Honourable Member for Chilliwack-Hope.
Well, Mr. Speaker, I find it troubling that that member would imply that a lawful House order was somehow illegal, that somehow that sending sending documents to the RCMP to do with what they will is somehow illegal. Mr. Speaker, we've seen this before. The government, we've seen the director of the CBSA, for instance, after the Arrive scandal, sent documents directly to the RCMP. The government has not chosen to do that in this case. We believe that a lawful House order is lawful. The RCMP will do what they want with that information, but that they should receive the information from the House of Commons unredacted, as is our right to request, which is what we have done, which is what the government should listen to.
Questions and comments?
The Honourable Member for Beauport-Limoilou. Thank you, Mr. Speaker. The role of the opposition in a government, especially a minority government, but all governments really, is not just to oppose for the sake of opposition. That would not be constructive. Rather, the opposition's role is, above all things, to ensure the public has a better view of current realities, allowing the public to be better represented here in the House. Having said that, trust is at the base of parliamentary power. Refusing to submit documents indicates that there is something to hide. This undermines public trust. As such, by refusing to submit documents, the government is shooting itself in the foot, especially given this minority government context. Here's my question. Does the problem come from the appointment process, or giving funds to an organization with no strings attached, or a bit of both? The Honourable Member for Chilliwack-Hope.
Mr. Speaker, and I'd like to thank my colleague for the question. I agree with her that the longer the government fights this matter by refusing to hand over the documents, the more it does look like they have something to hide. And clearly there was something wrong with the appointment process when it came to the board of the SDTC. We saw that the former minister, Navdeep Bains, was made aware that this would be a massive problem if he appointed Liberal-connected insiders who had been receiving money from this fund, that there would be inevitable conflicts of interest. He was told that repeatedly. The Prime Minister's office was told that repeatedly. The PCO was told that repeatedly, and all of it was ignored. And now we have a situation where $400 million has been awarded to companies that have a connection to Liberal insiders. We've seen, I believe the number I heard quoted from the member from South Shore St. Margaret's was 82% of the contracts had been impacted in one way or another and were under a cloud of suspicion. That's the record of this government, a program that operated just fine under the previous Conservative government was turned into a Liberal slush fund by this Liberal government, and they did it on purpose.
Questions and comments? The Honourable Member for Calgary Nose Hill.
Mr. Speaker, said that Canadians only will support our democratic system if they know in their hearts that the rules of our democracy are followed, right? That the rules of this place are followed and that all of us can represent them. It's a little wild to think that, you know, some of us represent over 120,000 people. We are one vote for 120,000 people, and the only way that that carries any weight is if the rules of this place are followed. My colleague spoke about the importance of parliamentary supremacy, the right of parliaments to do so many things, and our privilege as parliamentarians. Can he speak to the impact on what is happening to Canadians' faith in democracy when the government does not allow this place to function?
The Honourable Member for Chilliwack-Hope.
I thank my colleague and friend for that question. I think she has hit the nail on the head. If Canadians don't have confidence in their democratic institutions, they won't have confidence in the government to deliver services. They won't have confidence in the laws that we pass in this place. The whole system breaks down if the House of Commons is not supreme, if our rights and privileges are not upheld. And so that's why this is taken so seriously. That's why the Speaker has said that nothing else can happen until this matter is dealt with, because it is the most important thing that we can deal with, because if the privileges and rights of the House of Commons are undermined, then our democratic institutions are undermined. And it seems hyperbolic to say that, but that is what is at the foundation of this debate. If the government can simply ignore the will of the supreme lawmaking body in this country, if they can just brush that aside, what does that say about our democratic institutions? What does that say about our democracy? It says that it doesn't matter. It says that the government can do whatever it wants. There's nobody to hold them to account. And this official opposition, Common Sense Conservatives, will continue to hold this government to account by ensuring that the rights and privileges of the members of Parliament and this House of Commons are respected.
Questions and comments. The Honourable Member for London Fanshawe.
Mr. Speaker, I find it very difficult to listen to the Honourable Member talk about the rights and privileges of this place and that the rule of this place must be held supreme when, in fact, we know that the former Conservative Party of Canada did the exact same thing when they were in government. There are a number of scandals that they actively refused this House to learn about. A $3.1 billion anti-terrorism funding scandal, the G8 Summit slush fund, $50 million there. The list is quite extensive. New Democrats have talked about this before. We accept and want this investigated, absolutely. We want to ensure that whether scandals happen on a Liberal side or scandals happen on a Conservative side, that's not allowable, and that's not acceptable. But how can this member stand in this place and be so adamant about upholding the laws when their government or former government has just been as complicit as this current government?
That's right.
The Honourable Member for Chilliwack-Hope.
Well, thank you, Mr. Speaker, and I appreciate that old habits die hard, and it's tough for the NDP to stop defending the Liberal government, even though they supposedly have ripped up their confidence and supply agreement, and of course have continued to support their continued governance of this country through several votes over the last couple of weeks, keeping them in power. Of course, I reject the comparison between what happened under the Harper government and what is happening right now with this willful decision to ignore a lawful order of the House of Commons. That did not happen under Stephen Harper. And when these sorts of matters come up, we will call them out. We will hold this government to account. And I know that that member may want to live in the past and not hold this government to account, as they have not done for the last 9 years, but we'll do our job. We'll hold this government to account, even if the NDP wants to continue to support this corrupt Liberal government.
Questions and comments? The Honourable Member for Sandwich Gulf Islands.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. And I hate to alert my honourable colleague that I will ask a question that challenges something he said, but I want to put on the record first that virtually everything he said, I agree. I want to also thank the Honourable Member for South Shore St. Margaret's, because from corridor conversations, I'm quite aware that he seems to have done a whole lot more late-night, red-eyed reading through a lot of documents I haven't had time to read. I think that what we have here is a very large and important issue. I look forward to speaking to it later in debate today. I am very concerned with charter rights, but I fail to see a charter right being infringed here. I'm open to debate, to understanding how the Honourable Leader of the Government in the House sees a charter right infringing, but the right of this House to see documents and convey those to the RCMP doesn't raise to me a charter issue. So the quibble I have with my honourable friend from Chilliwack-Hope is this. I was here during the debates that we had right at the beginning of COVID. It was on March 23rd, actually. And just because on the record I like to see things corrected, the Honourable Leader of the Official Opposition now was the finance critic for the Conservative Party back then. But as much as I'd like to say how much fun we had working together, and we did, actually, we had the Honourable Leader, the new Democratic finance critic at the time, the Honourable Member from Burnaby, New Westminster, as well as the Honourable Bloc Québécois critic for finance, and I met regularly with former Finance Minister Bill Morneau, and were in astonishing levels of agreement. But it wasn't the member from the official opposition leader who spotted the little nugget. Everybody spotted it. As leader of the Green Party, I promise I spotted it. We were against parliamentary tradition because of COVID. Draft government legislation was shared with us before first reading. All of us saw it. The Parliamentary Budget Office flagged it. The finance minister can't give himself the right to approve budgets, several budgets in advance, so it never came to the House.
We are completely out of time, but the Honourable Member for Chilliwack-Hope can have a quick answer.
Yes, the Leader of the Opposition, the current Leader of Opposition, absolutely did flag it, and that's why the matter it was deleted from the draft legislation. So I don't know what role the member herself played, but I know on our side, I was the whip at the time. It was flagged by our current leader because he read through that document and was not willing to let the finance minister at the time undermine Parliament, as was the intention of the draft legislation.